Hello everyone, welcome back to QNET Live Broadcast. I'm your host Sam for the topic today, and we have our PM Frank here. And the topic today is that we will let you know how to use the pfSense as a firewall with our QNET NAS as a safeguard structure for your internet. And let's get into the slides. First, you can see that, well, speaking of the pfSense, we have been talking about this software for several times since the middle of last year, because we have launched our new Guardian NAS, which can easily install the pfSense and give you a very safe internet structure. So today we will let you know why you will need to have a pfSense in your network structure, and we will start on what you will face as your problem or threat when you are trying to build up your own internet infrastructure. And the second is how we can help you to solve all these problems by using the pfSense with our NAS. And then the third one will be the main topic today. We will give you the detail of the step-by-steps to set up your pfSense in any of our NASs that we will talk about today. And fourth, we will give you a live demo. Then we will show you the suggested models for all the QNET NAS that is suitable to install the pfSense. So Frank will start from the first topic, the network topology and the threat when you are trying to build up your own.
Hello everyone, I'm Frank. And today I'd like to show you how we can improve our cybersecurity on the NAS by using the pfSense. Because now the cybersecurity is much popular than before. A lot of people are talking about that, because before maybe only some enterprise or some IT guys, they will talk about the cybersecurity. But now more and more users, even at home user, what we call home user, they will also talk about the cybersecurity, because a lot of news telling that someone's picture has been stolen, someone's information has been released without any notifications. So more and more people are very seriously thinking about, okay, how I can improve my cybersecurity on my device. So today I will show you some scenario, is because based on our home user, we will show you some scenario which is very popular using at your home, then tell you some threat maybe you were facing it, the threat you may meet on your home usage. Okay, so the first topology is one of our home usage. If you get the internet connection from your ISP, you will have a connection to your ADSL modem, then modem dispatch the network to each smart device, maybe it's your televisions or QNAP NAS. And this smart device, they will get the dynamic IP go through the ADSL modem to the internet. So this is the first usual topology for home usage. Then next one is maybe some advanced user, they will ask their ISP to give them a static IP for the NAS. Maybe they need to have some special service on it. So they will have a static IP set up on the NAS, and the NAS then can go to the internet directly. It don't need to pass through the ADSL modem. This is another scenario. And the third scenario is also the user get the account, PPPO account from the ISP, and connect to internet. Maybe they only need a dynamic IP or static IP, depends on the ISP settings. But in this scenario, because they use the PPPoE, which means this is not one of our scenario for today's topic, because this is a more advanced usage. We will split to another topic to talk about more advanced usage for the scenario. So today we will not talk about this scenario, just let you know these three scenario is very usual. You can use it, you can see it at home. Mm-hmm. Okay, so we talk about the threat. What threat we may meet? Usually we will say that, okay, maybe your photos or your files on the NAS has been leaked to the internet. Maybe it's doing by hacker. Okay, the hacker just see, okay, you have some vulnerability on your NAS, or your NAS is not secure as well, so it will get into your NAS, grab these files and do what he liked. The most popular one is a famous one is 2014. This cloud have been hacked. A lot of pictures just leaked. And another one is maybe your NAS access to some phishing network, which is maybe you don't know it, or someone send some phishing applications to the NAS, and NAS just grab it, then become one of the phishing network. Because now one of the most hot line for this year is the 2020, the coronavirus related phishing website. It will show you, okay, I have a lot of information on this website. You can click this URL to get more details. Then you just click it, then you get into the phishing network. Mm-hmm. So this is two of the threat. But those two are more about is talk about the external, but actually a kind of a threat is coming from internally. Like this scenario is a bot device in your network. Maybe it's one of your PC, or some days your friends visit you and take his pad or his laptop and get into your ADSL modem to get to the internet, but it's already affected by some bot on it. Then it will start broadcasting. Mm-hmm. Ask that other device to become a zombie, because in the zombie network, it need to have more and more PCs. Just like right here, I said Bitcoin mining, because you need to have a lot of bot helping to do some mining things. So the zombie device will start to affect other PCs to become one of the zombies. So this is coming from the intranet. Mm-hmm. So this, no matter from the internet or intranet, they are all the threat for our home networking. So how we improve our cybersecurity by ourselves? Okay. So usually we talk about this, everybody will think about, okay, and then how about I install a firewall? I set up a firewall. Yes, that's correct. Because mm-hmm. set up a firewall is a very quick, and you can see what it looks like immediately. But usually you set up the firewall, you will think about three things. The one thing is high price. Mm-hmm. Usually the firewall is expensive. Mm-hmm. Okay. Then the second one is a complex setup. You need to set up a lot of rules on it, configure a lot of options on it. And the third one, usually a firewall is a standalone device. You need to find a space or a rack and plug in the power cord and plug in the copper cables, a lot of things on it. So usually you are facing this one, these three things. But if you think about it, if today we have a free, because it's open source, it's a free firewall, and a lot of extensions components on it, like IDS or GOIP on it, and you don't need additional hardware, why don't we use that? And that one is the pfSense. Today, what we are talking about is the pfSense. The pfSense is the open source firewall, which means you can use it for free. And it's also including the VPNs and the routing service on it. And this is a rule-based firewall. You just need to create the rules by rules for checking. And the perfect integrated to our QNAP NAS, because we are using the VM technologies, you just need to set up on our NAS. And just like I said, it have a lot of security extensions you can install by yourself, and choose the components what you like. Like if you need IDS, you just download the IDS component extensions and just install it. You can totally customize by yourselves. So how the pfSense play in the network? Here we have a scenario to show you where the pfSense it is. Right here, you can see on the left is one of the QNAP NAS, mm-hmm. and have ADS modems in the middles. And between the modem and the NAS is a pfSense right here. So the pfSense will locate right here. And it can help to control some IPs, no matter allow or deny. And also for the service. And the IP can be dedicated IP, or you can set up for dedicated countries. And also you can do the port scan deny. If you found somebody is doing the port scan, you can deny the connections. And for those functions, you need to also have a notification function on this, because if you have a security functions enabled on the firewall, but you don't know what he is doing, then maybe sometimes you are missing some information. But the pfSense by default, it have a notification function on it. You can depends on the behavior, set up different rules, send out the notification emails to maybe your administrator's email accounts, then you will get the email to tell you, okay, this time have somebody doing something and here's a log. You can do some setup or operations on your firewall. Okay, so then we will go to talk about how we install the pfSense on the NAS. But before we talk about the installations, we will show you how pfSense can be on the NAS. Usually we will talk about is two kind of the mode. The first one is the NAT mode. If we talk about the NAT mode, usually we will say that it will isolate the internet and the intranet, which means the device on the internet cannot access to the intranet. You can see these scenarios. Right here, we have an internet connect to your ADSL modem, and the ADSL modem have a DHCP server on it, which is broadcasting like a 111.0/24 subnet to the pfSense and then also NAS. And because this is NAT mode, so pfSense when can get the IP address with the same subnet from the ADSL DHCP server. But on the pfSense LAN side, it will have another DHCP server, which is broadcasting 1.0/24 subnet. And you can see on the right button, we have a PC right here. It's a get IP address with the pfSense LAN side. So it will have a 1.3 IP address. So now it's totally isolated intranet and the internet. So that's why we say the pfSense can be a DHCP server, assign IP for local device, and the device on the WAN side cannot access the LAN side device. Okay. And then the second one is the transparent mode, which means you can build up your transparent network. You can get IP address from the WAN side, even your PC is on the LAN side, which like this scenario. I have an ADSL modem, I have a DHCP on it, also broadcasting 111.0/24 subnet. And on the pfSense WAN side, get IP address, and also the PC gets the same subnet IP address from ADSL modem. Because they are all in the same subnet, which means they can connect to each other directly. You don't need to change your behavior, just type in the IP address you can access. So that's why I say transparent mode lets device on the pfSense WAN side can access device on the LAN side because they are transparent network. The advantage is the user, they don't need to worry about, I need to change my IP address. So maybe before I set up this IP address, then I need to change that. You don't need to change the IP address, which means your behavior, you just as is, you just do what you do in before. So how we choose to use the NAT or transparent mode? Here I have some samples for you. You can depends on your network to decide which mode you like to use. If you like to use NAT mode, it means maybe in your home, at home, you need another DHCP server to broadcasting the IP address, then you need to choose the NAT mode. But after that, which means because your WAN side device cannot access to LAN side directly, you need to set up like some port forwarding rules on your pfSense. So your user behavior, you need to be changed. But if you don't need a DHCP server, you just need to use the transparent mode. And the transparent mode, because all the device get the same IP, same subnet from your ADSL modem, so all the device were in the same subnet. You don't need to change the IP, which means you just need to use the IP as usual, then access to the NAS. So that's why we said if you want to use pfSense with QNAP NAS at home, we will suggest that you use the transparent mode, because in transparent mode. You don't need to change your IP address. You don't need to worry about, I need to set up another rules for different IPs. You don't need to worry about it. You just use the NAS as usual, because pfSense still helping you transparent all the traffic. It also doing some scanning on it, but it will not affect your user scenario. And before we talk about is the networking point of view, we show you how the home scenario looks like and where the pfSense put in. But in this page, I will show you more is the inside the NAS. Okay, because we talk about transparent mode, it will not change the network behavior, but how it looks like on the NAS. But here is the first pictures. Before we install the pfSense, the NAS just use the first network card, physical network card, like here is adapter one, get into the internet directly. And this is the, if we don't install the pfSense. But after we install the pfSense, because we need to set up the virtual switch, helping the pfSense binding the interface to the physical port. And right here you will see we will let our QTS or our NAS inside on the virtual switch and force the traffic pass through the pfSense, because we want to ask pfSense doing the scanning. So we need to let the traffic pass through the pfSense, but user will not feel anything different, because to the end the traffic still go to the internet from physical port one. Mm-hmm. So behavior not changed. We only change internally, and we only let the NAS communicate with the pfSense. This one, we do some modification, but for user, they just do as usual. They don't need to worry about, I need to change my behavior.
Okay.
Yeah. Okay, so in this scenario, we will do some more details for the, because we all have our demos in the past, in some slides, and here I will show you some scenario, including the IP address. I will do in the demos later. And right here, we have internet into our ADSL modem with the DHCP server on it, the 10.17/16 subnet, and connect to our NAS port 1, physical port 1, and port 1 binding to pfSense WAN side, and the pfSense LAN side binding to our NAS. QTS is our NAS, binding to our NAS, and also binding to physical port 2. And we have another PC physically connect to P2, get IP address from the ADSL modem. Mm-hmm. So which means two PC, the pfSense and also our NAS, they are all in the same subnet. Okay, and we install the pfSense on NAS by using the virtual machines, and helping us to do, because we said the pfSense is a rule base, so we will set up some rules to controlling, like I want specific IP address can access our NAS, others we deny it. And also we want to make sure our NAS can access to internet. Maybe you need to download some applications or internet, so we will make sure the NAS can access to internet. So we will go through step by step for installing. Of course, before we install it, we still will show you some internal deployment for the virtual switch, and what the relations between the physical network card, pfSense interface, how the relations it is. And also, we will show you a simple slide, make let you more clear. Then we will start install our pfSense, then go to NAS, deploy the networking, and do some modifications on the pfSense, also on the NAS. Then the last step is we will do a verification to make sure our firewall rules is working. Okay, so this page is to show you logical how the NAS virtual switch can bind in physical port and the pfSense interface, and how the packet flow it will looks like. And another very important thing is we like to show you how your physical corporate networking connected, because like right here, the physical port one, you just plug in your cables, connect to your ADSL modem, that's it. And the port two, if you need, you can plug in a physical cables, connect to maybe your PC directly, or you have a small switch, you just connect to those endpoint device. Depends on you. And for the port one, physical port one, it will binding to our virtual switch one, and the virtual switch binding to pfSense WAN side. And because we have a bridge mode, transparent, binding the WAN and the LAN on the pfSense. So which means the pfSense LAN, because it's already binding to our virtual switch two, and the virtual switch two also binding to the QTS, our NAS, and also the physical port two. Then we can make sure the device on the under the port two and the NAS can get the same subnets with the ADSL modem doing the transparent, and the pfSense just between the networking doing the scan. So this is the logically what the NAS will looks like after we set up the pfSense. Okay, then we will start configure the NAS virtual switch. Then we will start step by step to install the pfSense on the NAS. The first, you need to create the virtual switch, because as you can see in the previous pictures, the virtual switch is very important. It's binding the physical port and the pfSense interface. So right here, we need to create two virtual switch. Virtual switch one and virtual switch two. The first one binding to adapter one, the physical port one. Virtual switch two binding to adapter two, the physical port two. Then we can go to install the pfSense. The first step is we need to download the pfSense. Now we already have pfSense on our virtualization stations. You just need to go to virtualization stations, VM marketplace, download the pfSense. After you download it, it will ask you some criteria for installing. Right here, you will see, okay, you can choose how many CPU core you like to use. Usually we will suggest you use at least two cores, because consider about after you deploy the pfSense, you need to do some calculations, so you need to have a two core for it. And also 1 gigabyte the memory is necessary. Of course, if you have more memory, you can use higher than these values, but this is our suggestions. And you can choose which folder you like to install. After this, install it, you will see a brand new pfSense virtual machines inside your virtualization stations. Okay, then now the pfSense is already on your NAS. LAN is how we can access to the pfSense. One option is you can right here, like I show on the pictures, you go to the virtualization stations and click the virtual station. It will open a new terminal page. You can use a terminal to set up, config your pfSense. But I think most of people will like use the HTTP web page to manage the firewall. So you can also use the IP address. You can see right here on the terminal page, you will see WAN and LAN interface, which means this is the WAN and the LAN interface on the pfSense. So right here, you can see the WAN interface IP address is 10.17.104.99. Because when you access to the NAS, usually you also use the WAN side IP address. So this will in the same subnet with your PC and your NAS. So you just use this IP address access to the pfSense. And by default, the login account for pfSense account is admin. The password is pfSense. So you just need to type in the account and the password access to pfSense. Mm-hmm. Then maybe you will meet the first problem is, I use the right IP address, but why I cannot see the management page? Because by default, pfSense only allow part of the LAN IP address to access the pfSense web management page. Why pfSense doing that? Because it is a firewall. usually firewall will have a higher security level, so it don't like to let everybody can access to the page. So that's why he will only, it will only allow some part of the LAN IP address can access. But now we access from the WAN side, how we can access it? Have a workaround right here is we can temporarily disable the firewall on the pfSense. I say only temporarily because after a period of time or you do some config change, pfSense will automatically enable the firewall. Mm-hmm. Okay, so this is only temporary. How we can disable the firewall? You can also go to the virtualization stations and click the pfSense virtual stations like previous slides, and you will get into the terminal page. Inside the terminal page, you can see a lot of options from 0 to 16. You choose the number 8, share, press enter, then you can get into command line. Okay, and in the command line, you just need to press PFCTL space minus D. Okay, minus D, the D means disable. You can disable the firewall temporarily, then you quickly go into the firewall. Okay, set up the rules for your access. You can set up the rules to maybe you can get the IP address, because we have samples in the back. You can set up the IP address, what your PC looks like, and the access to the pfSense firewall directly. Set up the rules, and I will say this kind of a rule is only for workaround. Mm-hmm. This is of course not secure. So after you set up all the firewall rules, please make sure you delete this kind of rules, because this will be one kind of a vulnerability on your firewall. But this tip is not only for let you can access to the pfSense WAN site. It also can resolving some problem is after you set up some rules, then you find out you set up the wrong IP address. You block yourself out of the firewall. At that moment, you can also get into the pfSense, disable the firewall temporarily, and quickly log into the device, and modify the rules. Then you can get back the connections. So this is not only for access the firewall, it can also helping you if you do some wrong configurations on the pfSense. Okay, so after that means we can already access to our pfSense. Then we will start need to binding our virtual switch to the physical, also the pfSense interface. So right here, you go to the virtualization stations, VM list, and choose the pfSense VM. And go to setting, network. In this page, it's helping you to binding the virtual switch with the pfSense interface. Okay, so right here you can see we can assign the adapter 1. Adapter 1 means the WAN of the pfSense. We assign this to virtual switch 1 and assign adapter 2, LAN of the pfSense, to virtual switch 2 and confirm it. Then you will look like the picture on the left side. This picture you can see on the networking and the virtual switch overview. Right here you can see the virtual switch 1 binding the adapter 1 physical port 1 on the NAS and pfSense WAN interface, and the virtual switch 2 binding to physical port 2 on the NAS and the pfSense LAN interface. Then you finish the virtual switch binding. And then you remember that we talk about user will not feel the behaviors change, but we still need to make sure the communication sessions traffic all need to pass through the pfSense doing some scanning. So we need to assign a gateway to our NAS, make sure all the traffic will pass through the pfSense. So right here, we assign the NAS gateway into the virtual switch 2, which means on the pfSense LAN interface. All the traffic on the NAS will pass through pfSense LAN site to the WAN site, pfSense WAN site, then go to the internet, which means the pfSense can do the scanning. So right here, you go to the network virtual switch interfaces, we force our NAS gateway to the virtual switch 2. You need to do this manually. But right here, you may make a problem because for our designs, when you're doing the gateway option change, it only can choose the physical port it's on. But usually, at this moment, you only will plug in your physical network cables to the port 1. Your port 2 will be empty. So at this time, please connect copper connections to your port 2. And maybe you just connect to another PC or another switch. Force our physical port 2 up. Then you can choose it become your gateway for the NAS. After you confirm this setup, you can unplug the cables. That will be fine. You only need to plug in the cables when you choosing the gateway on the NAS. This is important. Okay. After you done this done these settings, you can unplug it. It doesn't matter. Okay. Until the step 2, we already set up the pfSense and also binding the virtual switch between physical port and the pfSense interface. Then we need to go to the pfSense to set up the transparent. The first step is we need to set up a transparent interface. Okay, we go to the pfSense interfaces bridges and we generate a new bridge interface. And it will ask you to choose the member. We would like to bind in the WAN side, LAN side into transparent mode. So right here, you choose WAN and LAN, press save. Then you will have a brand new bridge interface. After that, we put into the assignment for the pfSense because I want to use the pfSense to manage this transparent interface. So we go to the pfSense interfaces, assignment, add this interface into our pfSense interface. Right here you can see because my interface is called option 1, OPT1. So right here you can see it already have an interface on the pfSense. Then we need to set up the interface. Okay, we go to the pfSense interfaces, bridge interface. Right here, you can change your interface name. You can change what you like. Right here, I change it to transparent. You can use bridge or use the default setting. Their default setting is OPT1. Depends on you. Doesn't matter. But you need to remember which name you set up for your bridge interface because in the further step, you need to know which interface you need to set up. So right here, I choose transparent. This interface and I enable this bridge interface and the IP type I set up to DHCP client because it will get IP address from WAN side. So I only need to set up the DHCP client for this bridge interface. And also at this moment, the WAN and the LAN already become a bridge interface, which means the LAN interface. We don't need to use that for broadcasting the IP address. We just need to make sure it is enabled. So we go to the pfSense interfaces, LAN interface. We make sure the LAN interface is enabled. And we choose the IP type into DHCP client because we don't want to let this interface broadcasting IP address. It will mess up our network. Then you will see this error message. It will tell you you cannot change your LAN interface to DHCP client. Why? Because you have a DHCP server on it. By default, pfSense will set up the DHCP server for LAN interface because it is the NAT mode. I will show you later. By default, the pfSense is NAT mode. So we need to disable the DHCP server on the LAN interface. How we can disable it? We go to pfSense, services, DHCP server, and choose the LAN interface. You will see an options down there is the enable DHCP server on LAN interface. By default, it's checked. Just need to uncheck it, press save. You can disable the DHCP server. Then you just go back to the LAN interface. Then you can choose IP type into the DHCP client. So on the pfSense, you need to disable DHCP server, then choose the interface into the DHCP client. This is the one of the design on the pfSense. Okay, we already generate a bridge interface on pfSense and the binding the member when and the LAN. We need to turn off the NAT on the pfSense and change to transparent mode, because I already said by default pfSense is NAT mode. So how we can disable it? We go to pfSense, firewall, NAT, outbound, and in this page you can see have four options. Then we go to the right side, disable outbound NAT rule generations. We check this one, press save. And the second step is we go to pfSense, system, advanced system tunables. Right here, if you go into this page, you will see a lot of options on it. You need to find these two options. The first one, you change the value. You double click these options, get into the edit page, then change the value from 0 to 1. And the second options from 1 to 0, and press save. You need to modify these three options. You can totally change the pfSense from NAT mode into transparent mode or bridge mode. If you don't do these three steps, even you have a bridge interface on your pfSense, it will not working. So these three steps is very important. Okay, after that, we already set up the transparent. Then suppose our NAS, our bridge interface on the pfSense, they will get the IP address from the internet. But maybe at this moment you will go to the NAS and go to the pfSense and see why my interface cannot get the IP address. This is a kind of behavior on the DHCP. The first thing is DHCP, it starts asking for IP address, but it will only few seconds. After that, it will not, if it didn't get any response, it will stop broadcasting the request. So why the DHCP cannot get the IP address? Because I told you in the previous slides, pfSense by default, it have a hidden rules with deny all. It will deny all the traffic on the firewall. So you need to set some rules to pass the DHCP traffic. So here you need to set up a rule, allow rule for DHCP. You go to pfSense, firewall, rules, and choose the interface name. Like here, because I set up the transparent for my bridge interface, you go to the transparent and generate one new rule. Protocol is very important. Protocol, you need to choose UDP, and the source IP, you choose any, because I want to let all the DHCP can get the IP address. So source IP, any. And I don't know where the DHCP server it is, so destination, set up any. Destination port, I set up the 67. I only let DHCP pass through, because I will always keep these rules alive. So I want to make sure very specific. These rules only for DHCP, and press confirm. Then you will have allowed DHCP rules on your pfSense. Then you can go back to check your pfSense bridge interface. Suppose it will get the IP address and also on the NAS. But sometimes, like I said, DHCP is only broadcasting period of second, it's only second. After that, it will start broadcasting, asking for IP address. So maybe after you doing these configurations, on the interface, it already timeout. So you will see your transparent interface still cannot get the IP address. Then you just need to go to the pfSense interface and disable, enable this interface again, because this can force this interface sending out the DHCP request again, then it can get the IP address. So this is a little bit tip right here. If your interface, no matter NAS or on the pfSense, cannot get the IP address, maybe the first one is your firewall will block it, and the second one is your interface already stop it. You need to refresh it. Okay, till now, we already set up the pfSense, so we can say that now the pfSense is already running on our NAS systems, protecting your NAS. So now we need to put in the rules, because we say the pfSense is a rule-based firewall. You need to set up the rules on it, then you can manage the network. So right here, I choose a dedicated IP address can access to our NAS, and you can see the first rules. 10.17.94.18 is my PC's IP address, and my NAS IP address is 10.17.104.56. And I only allow TCP connection on this PC get into the NAS. So the protocol I choose TCP. This is my first rule. And the second rule is, as you know, I say I want to make sure NAS can get into the internet smoothly. So I set up my source IP address is my NAS IP address. Destination, any, I don't care. Okay, you just go into the internet. I set allow. And the number three and number four, these two rules is my, I used to set up this rule because I want to make sure my DHCP can get the IP address, and my DHCP client can get the IP address. And also all of my devices can resolve the domain. So I also allow the DNS right here. The DNS is UDP port 53. Okay, so I need to make sure my NAS, all the DHCP can get the IP address and I can resolve the domain. I will create another rules. And until here, maybe some experts will ask why I didn't have a default rule with the denial. Correct. And we don't need to do that because pfSense already done that. By default, it already have a hidden rule with denial, which means if you didn't set up allow rules in front of it, then this IP address will block by default rules. We will show you logs on next page, and then you will realize how the default rules looking. Okay, so after I set up these four rules, we can do some verifications. Right here, I change my NAS management port from 80 to 10,001. Then I go to the two PCs right here. Remember, I set up only one IP address, which is the 94.18, allow access to my NAS. Others, I deny it. So right here, I use another PC, 95.21 access to my NAS, and also 94.18 to access my NAS. And then we go to pfSense, status, system logs, firewall, normal view. You choose the firewall logs, you can see how it looks like. And right here, you can see on the right side, the snapshot. The first one is the IP address is coming from 95.21. And right here, you can see it's blocked by default deny rule. Then you can see, even we didn't set up a deny all, pfSense already used its default settings to block this IP address because I didn't set up an allow rule for this dedicated IP address. But I have one rule for 94.18. So on the bottom, you will see another pass logs right here. It shows that you manually created this IP address allow, so it's access to our NAS. So this is to verify how your firewall can work by these rules and can reach like this kind of result. You can allow, deny some IP address, no matter from by country or by specific IP address. And the service, I can control the service. I want to allow it or block it like before previous slides, because by default we block the DHCP, so let the DHCP not working. Then we create a rule for DHCP, then everybody can get the IP address. So the services can work in fine. And of course, because I block some IP address, you know, maybe that IP address is doing some unusual behavior, so we block it, and then it can do, it cannot do the like a port scans. And also, because in the previous slides we show you pfSense a lot of extensions you can install it. In the future we will tell you more advanced use like some IDS IPS systems on the pfSense. You just need to install those kind of extensions. You can customize into your file. Your file will become another IDS also. Firewall plus IDS. Okay. It can be done on the pfSense, but this will be more advanced. We will show you in another topic. Mm-hmm. So this is the result we can do. So I will show you, I use my NAS to show you how it looks like I installed a pfSense on my NAS and how we deploy it. And this is my NAS right here. I will show you because I already set up a pfSense on the NAS. So you can see other virtualization stations. I already have a pfSense right here. And you just click it, then it will open a new tab with the terminal. And the terminal is, like I said, you can see what the when, then bridge interface IP address looks like. And also you can do, like I say, if you want to temporarily disable your pfSense firewall rules, also you can disable right here. And I show you how the virtual switch looks like right here. Again, this is my NAS. You can see this one is my physical port 2 binding to virtual switch 1, then binding to pfSense virtual adapter 1, which is the WAN side on the pfSense, and the virtual adapter 2 on the pfSense, which is LAN binding to virtual switch 2 and to physical port 2 on the NAS. And this is the topology it looks like. And the like I say, because we need to make sure the NAS, all the traffic can pass through the pfSense, let the pfSense so can scan it. So we need to make sure our gateway on the NAS is connected to pfSense LAN side. And the pfSense LAN side is binding to virtual switch 2, physical port 2. So right here you can see I binding my NAS default gateway into adapter 2. So this means my traffic on the NAS will go through pfSense LAN side and get into pfSense WAN side to the internet. pfSense can secure my networking, and I don't feel anything different between that because all the checking is doing by pfSense. I will not feel it. So this is the setup on the NAS. Then we can go to pfSense web page to see what I've done on these settings. The first thing you remember, I need to generate a bridge interface on the pfSense. So right here you can see on the interfaces bridge, right here I already generate a bridge interface. And I also assign to one of the interface on the pfSense. So you can see right here. Now I have one bridge. I set up the naming. This is the naming I say you can change by yourself. Right here I set up BR01 for my transparent interface. Then I just right here I enable this interface and make sure my DHCP set up to DHCP client. And after I set up the bridge interface on my pfSense, I need to change pfSense because by default it is NAT mode. I need to change to transparent mode. So I go to firewall, NAT, and outbound right here. I choose this option, disable outbound NAT rules generations. Then the second step, I go to system, advanced, system tunables right here. These two options, we need to modify it. Because I already modified it, so these two options will go to the top. But maybe right here, this option will, on the middle of these options, you can use like search functions on the browsers, search these options and double click it, and then go into the modifications right here, like here. I can modify it from 0 to 1 for these options. Then after you save these options, means your pfSense is totally coming into the transparent mode. Then from the NAT mode. After that, we need to set up our firewall rules, doing some controlling. So right here, I go to, because now I all let my traffic working on my bridge interface. So I go to the firewall rules, choose my bridge interface. And right here, you can see I set up these rules for my DHCP client traffic. This one for my DNS, I need to let traffic can resolve the domain. Then I want to make sure my NAS can go to the internet smoothly. This is my NAS IP address, 10.3.188.108. This is my NAS IP address. And I set up my management PC. Now this PC is my management PC. I want to let my management PC can access to my NAS. So I set up my IP address 10.3.188.105 can access my NAS IP address. And also my colleague, they also need to manage my NAS. So I also create another rules for them. After that, how we can make sure my firewall rules is working. So we can go to status, system logs to check firewall logs. Right here is all the logs we triggers on my pfSense. Then we can go to check, like I want to know if someone connecting to my NAS. Right here you have a filter. You just need to, because this is my IP address on the NAS, I just need to fill in and press my filter. Okay, so it looks like no one trigger some unusual connection to my NAS. Right here, all you can see is all my PCs right here connect to NAS. So that means in this scenario, my networking is secure. No one else connecting to my NAS. Or you may look like if someone, I don't let them to allow, this is my networking like this one. Mm-hmm. You have someone, maybe he don't want to access to my NAS. He want to access because this is broadcasting. I don't know what he looks like. He want to do, but he's doing some networking access on my networking. So right here you can see have a logs rules right here. Default deny rule. Okay, I didn't set up any deny all rules on my firewall, but you can see right here have a logs showing pfSense do have a default deny rule right here. So if you didn't allow some IP address get into your network, it will trigger your default deny rules on the pfSense. So this is to show you how my NAS setup with the pfSense and how I use my pfSense to controlling, to manage my network, to secure my network. Okay, so this is I show you on the GUI. Then we can go to, because we have a lot of NAS can deploy the pfSense, so what we suggest for you set up my our pfSense. We have a lot of series right here. You can see like X51, 53 series, which is easy deployment, low bandwidth requirement, till the enterprise usage like X83, X85 series, high performance, high bandwidth required. All these series can install the pfSense. You can use the pfSense to secure your NAS, avoid some cyber threat from the internet or intranet. You can co-work with our NAS very smoothly to enhance your network security. Mm-hmm. Okay, so this is our topic today, to install the pfSense on our NAS to secure your NAS.
Yes, and we brought a very detailed introduction in the process of how you can set your pfSense in all of our QNAP NAS in all the series that we have shown you. So if you want to get to the video again, you can go to YouTube and use QNAP and pfSense as the keyword to find our video today. Then in the future, we will keep bringing you different topics of the videos, and we hope you enjoy the video today, and we will see you next time on QNAP Live Broadcast. Bye.